From the 26th chapter of Matthew. Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. A servant girl came to him and said, "You also were with Jesus the Galilean." But he denied it before all of them, saying, "I do not know what you are talking about." When he went out to the porch, another servant girl saw him. She said to the bystanders, "This man was with Jesus of Nazareth." Again, he denied it with an oath, "I do not know the man." After a little while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter, "Certainly you also were one of them, for your accent betrays you." Then he began to curse, and he swore an oath, "I do not know the man." At that moment, the cock crowed. Then Peter remembered what Jesus had said, "Before the cock crows, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly. The word of the Lord. Do you remember all of those lessons you learn in early childhood or kindergarten? How to share, to clean up your room, to play nicely with others, for example. But perhaps the most important lesson we learn is to tell the truth. We must not lie, and certainly not when questioned directly. That is why it is so shocking when a person who is caught in the act of a crime would still lie or make excuses when directly confronted about the event in question. Often children will point the finger at someone else and try to deflect the blame. But teaching children not to lie is a foundational part of parenting and growing into a responsible adult. Even from the very beginning in the Garden of Eden, we see the tendency to point the finger at others. Adam lashed out both at God and at Eve when questioned about eating the forbidden fruit. What separates adults from children, or from those less mature, is taking responsibility for one's actions. A large part of being a mature adult is owning up to the truth and accepting the consequences. We must be willing to defend our choices rather than running from them. As adults, we face unique challenges even when telling the truth. We know sin is in the world and that dishonesty abounds. We're used to the idea that everybody is trying to sell us something, making promises knowing they can't or won't deliver on. So what do we do? If we're trying to convince someone that we're telling the truth, many people say something like, "I swear on my mother's grave," or "I swear to God." We're not even taken aback by those words anymore. Why don't we remember the Lord's command, "Let your yes be yes and your no be no"? Anything more than that comes from evil. You see, perjury would normally be a very difficult crime to prosecute. The burden of proof is on me to show you that the defendant, Peter, knowingly lied while under oath. Usually such an oath would take place in a legal context, in a courtroom. But perjury can happen anywhere. There's a broken oath. And I'm sure my colleague over there will try to spin some heartbreaking tale, but the facts are quite clear. We heard in the reading that Peter said, and I quote, "denied it with an oath, saying, 'I don't know the man.'" We know his testimony is false because only a day earlier, he had made another promise to Jesus that even if everyone else fell away, Peter would stay no matter what. He promised that he would stay faithful even if he had to die with Jesus. And if the evidence on the record wasn't enough, we have anecdotal evidence as well that tells us shortly before the denial in question, it was the very man who cut off the ear of the priest's servant Malchus. Later, in the face of being caught red-handed as a disciple of Jesus, the defendant Peter reverted back to childlike, obviously false behavior, denying that he followed or even knew Jesus. Part of being an adult is that you cannot escape the consequences of breaking the law or denying your participation in events. Peter took an oath before God, denied Jesus, and did so on multiple occasions. He is guilty of perjury. But then again, aren't we guilty as well? Haven't you violated a solemn pledge and oath to Jesus as well? You might be asking, what oath did I take? Every time you say a creed, you confess your belief in who God is. In baptism and confirmation, you affirm your belief in God and the promise to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, to serve all people, and to strive for justice and peace. And yet, how often have your actions denied Jesus or hurt your neighbors? Even when asked directly, do you mumble a response that's just vague enough to make others think you might or might not be a Christian? As a Christian, you are called to be salt and light to the earth. Scripture says that a lamp isn't hidden, but put on a lampstand to give light to the world, to the whole house. How brightly has your light shone, if at all? Each and every one of you, your sins are in a public denial of your faith you confess in Jesus. You see, it's not difficult to understand why Peter is guilty of perjury, because you are guilty of perjury on a daily basis, and it is a very serious crime.
What is the most traumatic event that you've ever witnessed? Sometimes when we see an event so frightening or unreal to us, it's as if our mind shuts off and we watch in a daze. The horrifying events seem to take a place in slow motion. Put yourself in the place of Peter. He had just seen Jesus arrested. And for what? For teaching the scriptures in the synagogues? For making the Pharisees uncomfortable in their self-centered lifestyles? Peter surely worried in that moment when the servant girl said that she recognized him as a follower of Jesus. Having seen Jesus arrested and taken to trial, it was as if Peter reverted back to a childlike attitude and immediately began denying everything, regardless of the facts of the situation. It's obvious and indisputable that Peter was Jesus' follower. He was such a follower of Jesus that Jesus had promised that the church would be built on Peter's confession of faith concerning his Lord's true identity as the Son of God and the Messiah of Israel. We all make promises. Of course, these promises are made with the best intentions and the desire to see them through to completion. Certainly, Peter meant what would later be looked at as a bold promise. It was just that the reality of life is that sin is all around us. Circumstances change. One day we're able and the next unwilling. It's just the cold, hard truth. Regardless of the promises you have made and broken, the perjury you commit with your words and actions, contrary to your promise of faithfulness to Jesus, take comfort in this. Peter is second perhaps only to Judas in his betrayal of Jesus at the worst possible time. Peter, though he denied Jesus not one, not two, but three times, was forgiven by Jesus. And do you know why that is? Because Jesus always keeps his promises in his word. The Bible tells us that if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us. We see Peter's repentance as he goes out and weeps bitterly after his denials. Peter knows what he has done and is torn up by remorse. Yet only a few days later, Jesus speaks to him, maybe even in front of the other disciples, and offers Peter three more opportunities to answer the same question. He asks, "Peter, do you love me?" Peter responds, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." After these three confessions of faith, Jesus responds, "Feed my sheep." Peter is restored to discipleship. But Jesus does not only restore Peter, the Lord gives you his promises as well. Promises that come directly from the throne of God. He promises that he will come again and that he will take you to be with him. He promises that you are his child whom he loves and that you have the Holy Spirit who creates and sustains your faith. He promises that because Jesus is the resurrection and life, even though you die, yet you shall live. You see, it's not about the number of promises you have made or broken, or about the perjury you've committed. It's all about the strong Word of God. The Word that existed before creation, that took on human flesh and was born among us on the first Christmas. The one who followed the path of the cross that we follow during the season of Lent. Jesus, the Word, took that path and took up his cross for you. Each of our lies, perjuries, and all of our other sins were nailed there with him. And now those sins are gone forever. Even though it may feel as though you wear the rags of sin, in the sight of God, you are dressed in a shining robe of righteousness. That is a promise. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.